Shark Nation. Welcome to another episode of the Shark Pod live from Greystone Studios. We've got Mark Baker out there in Glenageary. How are you doing, Mark?
Good. Good to be here, Luke. How are you?
I'm very well. I'm about to, I hope to learn something today, you know. I've got Owen O'Malley actually up in Donegal on the line as well. How are you doing, Owen?
Grand. Glad to be on the podcast. Thank you for hosting us.
Thanks very much. So Owen is the works in the investment network, investment club network. And it is something that is very interesting for us the last kind of month or so, ever since we had Michael Houghton on. Shout out to Michael. He was kind of a financial freedom guy as well. He really, you know, got me and Mark thinking. And then when our old friend Jamie White kind of introduced us, we knew we wanted to get you on the podcast as well. Jamie's out there in Bali. Well, I'm following him on Instagram. I can't wait for his updates. He's doing acro yoga out there, Mark.
Living the dream.
So fair play to Jamie. Wish him all the best. Hopefully we'll have a follow up with Jamie one day and see how he's getting on out there in Bali. But let's have a chat about investments. It's the beginning of the year. Maybe Owen, if you wouldn't mind giving the listeners a bit of a background of what you're doing, how you got into the investment game, all that type of stuff, just to give us a bit of a setup here.
Yeah, sure. I mean, my background was, my degree is environmental science. My background was in salmon farming. That's what took me to Donegal. So for 12 long years, I grew salmon. I had a pair of wellies and a scuba tank on the back of my back, and came across Tony Robbins back in 1993. Did one of his seminars in London. His first time he actually came to Europe, called UPW. We did a bit of a fire walk and had a bit of a blast for 4 days. At the very end of it, he had this big upsell where he said, once a year, we bring the top investors from all over the world to a central location called Hawaii, the big island of Kona. So out we go, March of 1996, and we get to spend 6 long days, Tony Robbins long days, 8 a.m. to 2 a.m. and back again for 6 long days. We got to listen to and learn from 24 of the wealthiest people on the planet at that time. And they were all immersed in the stock market, either companies they started and then floated in the stock exchange, or they actually just actively traded the stock market. So we learned tons over those 6 long days. I came back and I started to trade the stock market part-time alongside the day job, which is perfect because the stock market is open 2:30 to 9 p.m. Irish time. So you have a couple of hours in the evening when you come home from work. So after about 18 months, I was making more money selling options once a month on my shares than it was for my paycheck. And I was fairly well paid. I was in a Norsk Hydro as a multinational company. So I had a company car, a pension, a good salary at the time. And yet I was able to have that decision. Do I stay? Do I leave? So I stayed for another 6 months to make sure it wasn't, you know, it was consistent. And after 2 years of trading, I was able to effectively retire. And just purely by accident, most of my guys in the area, because where we live is a small community, they thought I was crazy. You know, they saw this guy running a fish farm, company car, pension, blah, blah, blah. Why is he giving this all up? And I said, well, why didn't we form an investment club? It was back in the days of the punts, guys, way before the euro. And I said, we'll put 55 punts a month into the kitty each. We'll have our own bank account that belongs to all of us. We'll have our own trading account, and I'll show you how this all works. And then one investment club became 2, became 10, became 100, became 1,000. We've set up investment clubs in over 50 different countries now. We've taught our courses in 15 different languages. We've written 7 books translated into 6 different languages. So that's what we do. And that's the journey to where we are today.
It's amazing. So when you, back in the day when you're kind of, you're, like you said, you're in your wellies and you're a scuba tank. And then like how, so in 1993, how are you even getting the information about the stock market back then? Was there some kind of like a teletext style setup that you could subscribe to, or how did you know what to be investing in and stuff like that?
Well, this is back in the day of the fax. So after we did the Tony Robbins Wealth Mastery course, they did this service called an action fax, where they sent you a fax every day with an overall summary of the stock market plus 3 potential plays that you could do. Okay. So that's how we actually started our journey with this action fax. So we had our very first investment club with 7 members, and it used to come to me first, and I would tick the box of which one I think we should do. And then we would daisy chain it around to everybody. It used to come in at 8 a.m. in the morning, and then the stock market home at 2:30. So by 2:30, the trader of the club got the votes, and then he placed the trades.
Okay, interesting.
That was the early days.
And when you came across Tony Robbins in 1993, was that from reading a book that he had published, or did you, like, how did you find yourself in in a Tony Robbins event.
Yeah, I picked up his book called, his very first book called Unlimited Power. Well, his very, very first book was called Fit for Life, but it was co-written. But his first book written by him was called Unlimited Power. So that was how I heard about him.
And Mark Baker, this has come up a lot of times with Tony Robbins stuff. I know for me, Owen, I grew up with a mom at home, and she was always trying to put lots of positivity in there. So every Christmas I get Tony Robbins books and stuff like that. So it's had a big impact on me. But Mark, that's kind of a trend here with Tony Robbins. A lot of people that are out there doing things, making things happen, are kind of get kicked off with Tony.
Yeah, I think a lot of people would roll their eyes at Tony Robbins and that kind of, self-help stuff. But I think he's certainly helped a lot of people. He's in the peripheral. He's kind of motivating. And then some people are directly going to the courses, have all the books. And I can only see people benefiting from his work, really. So I don't understand why people do the eye roll and don't take it serious, because some of the highest performers in the world are advocates of Tony Robbins.
Absolutely. So so Owen, when you went to the first one, you said it was the firewalks and stuff like that. Was it, it was maybe the first one in Europe. Was it in a kind of a hotel? Because what I'm picturing now, Tony Robbins, he's doing stadium type things. He's doing big arenas. What was the vibe back then?
Yeah, it was reasonably sized events back then. I think maybe about 1,000 people at it. And then his events we went to, he did this thing back then called Life, University of Life. So we did a session on financial, which was a 6-day event. We then did Day with Destiny. And then we did Life Mastery, which was physical mastery, emotional mastery, leadership, all that good stuff. But yeah, even back then he used to attract top speakers. He had Norman Schwarzkopf, who was the big general who was the guy that ran the U.S. Army in the Iraq War or Kuwait War back then. So he was the guy teaching leadership. He had a guy called Deepak Chopra was doing this kind of spiritual stuff. He had another guy called Stu Middleman who had ran across America. He literally ran 60 miles a day for 60 straight days, ran 3,600 miles from east to west coast of America. He was teaching physical mastery. So he was, back then he was bringing in some of the top guys in the game and basically teaching their strategies to us. Even today, Serena Williams, Tony's personal coach, Hugh Jackman, Tony's the personal coach. So all the top performers in the world today use Tony one-on-one. They pay him $1 million a year to be their coach.
Wow.
Yeah.
Good. Well, it must have been a big investment at the time for you, was it?
Massive. It was crazy. It was back then. Back in 1995, it was something like 10,000 punts to buy the whole gig, the whole Life Mastery. So that's probably about 50,000 euros today with inflation and the change of exchange. And right. So I signed up not knowing how the fuck I was going to pay for it, because back then I was just paycheck to paycheck. And I came home and we had two cars. I think I had something like a Volkswagen Jetta at the time. And so I figured I'd sell my car and we can use the one car. And that's how I actually paid for it. I sold my car for, and it's amazing because I put it for sale and I got the exact price of the seminar, 10 grand. So that's what did it, yeah. It was the best investment of my life, you know.
Best. Okay, so that's sometimes these type of people, they're kind of pushing people to invest in themselves as well. And people are kind of a little bit shy about doing that. I know that I am sometimes, if there's a course or something that I think that would be beneficial. But then it's easy to say, I won't see the money back from that or whatever. I took a course recently and I've been in sales for probably 15 years altogether. I started door-to-door sales selling an Aircom phone watch. So if you're out there in Ringsend and you bought a phone watch from somebody 15 years ago, it's probably this guy. But
that's when you were in your nappies, Luke, was it?
Yeah, I was 16 and I had an oversized suit. And I used to go out when it was raining because I knew that people would feel sorry for me and maybe give me time for my elevator pitch.
Puppy eyes.
Yeah, exactly. So an ill-fitting suit out there from Moore Street or whatever, or equivalent. So my point was, I've been in sales for a long time and I took a course, I took a Sandler sales course because my work were kind of putting up the money for it. And it was brilliant. I really enjoyed it. Got loads from it. And I've been implementing a lot of the strategies straight away. So I think people need to take a second look when they're developing themselves. Yeah.
Absolutely. I agree 1,000%. It's the greatest. I mean, Warren Buffett is one of the richest men in the world. He says the greatest investment you can make is in yourself. And I mean, that the return on that investment has been, you know, thousands fold since then. So it was a great investment.
And does Tony Robbins still do those events or what they
do? He does. Yeah, well, since COVID, obviously. But yeah, I mean, he does this massive thing called Day with Destiny. About 6,000 people go to. In fact, if you're, for the listeners and the viewers, if they go to Netflix and they type in, I'm not your guru.
I've watched it, yeah.
For the first time in 40 years, Tony's let the cameras in behind the scenes of his house where he lives and how he actually runs that five-day event and the meeting, team meetings he has before it and during and after. So it's a phenomenal. But yeah, no, he runs those events, absolutely. People get, like, unbelievable. Like, I've watched him do interventions because not only did I attend his events initially, as a kind of a give back, I staffed some of his events for free because you were getting closer to him. In fact, a good story. Back in 1996, I invited him to Ireland to speak. And I said, look, you know, we'll put together a seminar for you. And he said, well, I'm really busy now. I'm chock-a-block. So send your people to me and I'll look after them. So in 1996, I worked with Frankie Sheehan of the Pendulum Summit. And we finally got Tony to come to Ireland. And we had 3,500 people at the Pendulum Summit. It was a brilliant, brilliant event.
Wow. It's amazing. And so if we go to the day that you say, okay, I'm done with the fish, let's cast back a little bit on the fish part, and you're finished with that, what's that decision like for you? Are you saying, okay, there's no point in me putting on the wellies anymore? What's the difference? What's the or was it more that you were going after a bigger vision after the Tony Robbins seminars?
So I guess it starts with my dad. My dad always worked for himself. My dad was in construction in London. He would have emigrated from Mayo in 1956 to 76. So he worked his ass off for 20 years in London in construction. And he often tells the story that him and my mom, his wife at the time, they remember walking by the Thames in the early days in 1956, and they threw their last penny into the Thames. They had nothing. They were, whatever they earned that week was done. And like he did very well there. He sold a house again back then for over $1 million back, which was a lot of money back in 1976. And so he always used to drum into me, listen, working for somebody else is fine. You learn things, but don't stay there forever. You should work for yourself. So that was always drummed into me, figure out a way to work for yourself. So back in I joined the fish farm in 1986. And back then, it was a very progressive company. They used to give us B shares in the company. So we were making, and if you understand the way preferential shares work, you can be paid tax-free. It's a legitimate way to pay tax-free. And so I was getting big lump sums because back then we used to grow the salmon for £3 a kilo and sell it for £5 a kilo. And it was a good profitable business. In fact, we almost floated on the Dublin Stock Exchange. One year we turned over 10 million, made 2.5 million profit. And so these guys from Ernst & Young were coming up looking at it, what are these guys with wellies doing making all this money? And then the Norwegians who part owned the company decided that we weren't going to float on the Irish Stock Exchange. They were going to buy out the Irish shareholders. So they bought us all out. Yeah. And after that, it became a day job. So what was in my mind, my dad saying, look, you got to work for yourself. So that's what got me thinking. And back then I used to study the SME. You know, SME had a journal, the Small to Medium Enterprise Board in Ireland used to have this newsletter. And they used to describe businesses. And I saw this survey one year that said 85% of businesses that start up fail in the first 5 years. And then they also said another interesting thing is that the average return or the average profit margin of a small to medium-sized business in Ireland was about 5%. And then it also said that very few businesses turn over more than $1 million. And I was doing the maths. I says, look, if they're turning over $1 million, they're only making 5% profit, that's a 50 grand. And I'm making 50 grand in the fish farm. So it doesn't fucking add up. Yeah. So then I parked that. And then when I went to Tony Robbins and he said, we're going to take these top investors in the world who are the wealthiest people on the planet. They're going to distill their decades of knowledge and information in days. I said, right, these guys know what they're talking about. So they said everything. They said, look, the fourth quadrant from Kiyosaki is get the money to work for you. Don't work for money. Don't have a company. Don't employ people. Just buy shares in great companies. And another concept they said back then, which really struck home with me, is back then Bill Gates was just going with Microsoft. And back then he owned a big percentage of Microsoft. And they said, look, if you buy a share in Microsoft, Bill Gates works for you because the primary responsibility of a of executives of companies to increase shareholder value. So if you want to employ the best and brightest minds on the planet, just buy the best companies in the world, and the CEOs of those companies work for you because they get out of bed every day to increase your shareholder value. And that was a, that blew my mind. This is how you can employ the best people in the world.
That's an incredible way to kind of frame that, and something I've never come across before. But when you think about it, that's absolutely right. It's the it's why just before I know we're like I'd love to pick your brain on kind of maybe some strategy or what people could be doing if they're getting started, that type of thing. But like just from a psychology point of view, now that you've set up these this huge amount of investment clubs, and you've come into contact, I'm sure, with a huge amount of people who are getting going and investing, how come people wait so long to have that kind of penny drop with them that owning is better than working? True.
Yeah, I think it's just through the education system. Did you press the video by mistake, or is it, did you do it intentionally?
Oh, sorry?
Yeah, you've shut down the video. Do you know, is that on purpose?
No, it wasn't on purpose.
Oh, yeah, no. Sorry.
Okay. Yeah, I can see.
So the question is, why does it take people so long for the penny to drop of you should be working for yourself and blah, blah, blah? I think it's to do with society. And you know, I remember my son has been trading the stock market since he's 8. He's out in Bulgaria. I just had a Zoom call with him before we spoke. I told my son how to invest when he's 6. He's been investing since he was 8 years of age. And I remember when he was getting on the bus to go to secondary school, and I said to him, son, before you get in that bus, remember every single one of those teachers cannot teach you to become financial free because they're not financial free themselves. So from our parents to our teachers to even the church, there's nobody telling us that this thing is possible. It's not in our worldview. And so a majority of people just don't know it exists.
Because I've only really started investing properly, as in like getting, I've been a bit of a saver. So all the stuff I've made, I've been just stacking it up for no reason. I'm no better off really for it. And it just gets eroded away.
Because it loses 2% a year.
Exactly. So what I'm trying to do now is have kind of a focus plan. And I'm investing for the long term. So I just had a baby last month, and I've thanks very much. I opened an account with him kind of in mind to say, okay, maybe in 20 years time, this will be worth a huge amount for him. Do you look at me? And then he'll only be 20, and then we can kind of pass it on. So that's kind of where my head is at. But when I worked in Davies Stockbrokers, I was actually in valuations. So I was working with every kind of the wealthy people that they were managing their funds for. And I would go through every investment and try to figure out how much they were worth. There wasn't much of a formula, but anyway, I would see the gains that these people were making, but it always seemed like it was out of reach. It always seemed like they'd already got there and they were just kind of sitting on it. Because I was in the high net worth section, everyone was kind of like a million and up, basically the valuations that I was doing. So it kind of looked like this is only for the rich people. Like, how do I'm making, at the time I was probably making like 30 grand a year. How am I going to chop that up enough to make that work? But I guess you got to start somewhere.
Yeah, you got to start somewhere. And that's what we've helped a lot of people over the last 20 years. Like, we've taken about 20,000 people through our education system. And we say to everybody, even today, you can join an investment club with 100 euros a month. Okay, 100 euros a month and you're in the game. That 100 euros a month goes into the market. So if you've got 20 people in the club, that's 2 grand month one, 4 grand month two. You know, after 5 months, it's 10 grand. After, 10 months, it's 20 grand. It becomes significant. And the beauty about an investment club is, there's almost like three different skills you need to be successful in the market. You need to be good analytical skills. You need to be good with numbers to recognize value, read balance sheets, blah, blah, blah. You need to have good visual skills to be able to recognize charts, because the market moves in predictable patterns, just like human beings are predictable. Like, we run seminars, and 2-day seminars, or we used to before COVID. It's all online now. But on our 2-day seminars, whoever sat in the same seat day one, they sat the exact same day two. That's a predictable pattern. The stock market is exactly the same, because it's just driven by human beings making decisions from fear and greed to buy and sell. And that actually has patterns. And there's a famous thing called an Elliott wave pattern, which was discovered back in, it's based on the Fibonacci numbers, which goes back to a monk 400 years ago. A mathematician discovered that there was a certain ratio that the way things evolved over time. And then this accountant called Elliott in 1925 said, oh, I wonder, does that apply to the stock market? So he discovered the Elliott wave pattern, which basically means the stock, when they go from A to B, they never go in a straight line. They go up and then they pull back a bit. Then they go up a bit and they pull back and they do that third and final roll. And then the pattern changes. And so a lot of people struggle with that visually because you need visual skills. And the third and final skill set you need to be successful in the market is to be almost like a chess player. You know, think of the Queen's Gambit. You've got to see the next move ahead, because when you trade the stock market, you've got to know why you're doing it. You've got to know what you want from it. Like, what are you going to get in the future? You need to know when to close the trade. And you need to also have a plan B, because it may not move in the direction that you're anticipating. So if you've got a good analytical brain that can study the figures, a good visual brain that can see patterns, and a good, if you like, strategic brain that casts your mind into the future, says, here's what we're going to do when it does this in the future. Those three skills, you may not have them all yourself, but in a group of 20 people, you have it. It's a very powerful team. So a third, a third, a third. About a third of the team will be visual, a third will be analytical, and a third will be able to plan ahead in the future as well. Does that make sense?
That makes sense. It makes a lot of sense. Like, it's more of a kind of a hive mind of everyone coming together to give what they the best parts of them, rather than, so if someone's a great, like I said, analytical person, but maybe risk adverse, they can have somebody else to kind of maybe soothe them a little bit. So you mentioned that set up these in 50 countries. How did you get that message out? Just out of curiosity, how do you grow the network to that kind of size?
Again, the journey started with Tony Robbins. One of the speakers that Tony Robbins put in front of us in 1996 was, and you can look them up, Google them, they're probably all dead now, but it was a group of grannies called the Beardstown Investment Club. The Beardstown was a very small town in the back of the USA. And these grannies, and they were literally grannies, decided to work together and invest. And they came up with a system to score a company for quality and score a company for value. And they used to also go and interview the CEOs of the companies, like Caterpillar and Coca-Cola. They used to go and meet with the investor relations team and ask them key questions. And so they had done 34% return that year. And I think the S&P 500 had done something like 8% that year. So they'd beaten the market by 3 or 4, factor of 3X or 4X. And they said to us, look, everybody's focused on the day-to-day living and they just live from day to day. You've got to meet with a group, a peer group or a mastermind group, and focus on wealth creation. And they said, when you go back from the seminar, form an investment club. So that's exactly what I had in mind. So after I tested it myself and knew it worked, I approached two other people and said, let's form an investment club. And then 3 became 5 and 5 became 20. And we eventually had a full investment club. So it just grew organically. I've never paid money for advertising. I've been interviewed many times on radio, TV, but only people, because they heard about us in different countries as we went around the world. So just start with one investment club, and then somebody in that one investment club said, come to Sligo. I know some people in Sligo. Then go to Longford. Then go to Cork. It spread all over Ireland, and then it started to go international. Because one guy in Cork said, I'm going to move back to Australia. He was Australian, so we went to Australia. So it's just grown by word of mouth. That's how it's worked.
Wow. And what's a typical size of the club? Are they like professional backgrounds, or is it a mix between?
It's very mixed. Oh, very mixed. It's about 40% female, 30-40% female. Let's say about 35% female, 65% male. It's all ages, all backgrounds. It's retired bank managers that want to keep their minds active. It can be kids. We allow kids to be in the club, and then they sign the paperwork when they're 18. So it's a whole range of backgrounds, age groups. They just have that desire to want to know how it works and can see the benefit of working as a team.
That's interesting as well. I love that you can get kids involved as well, because I think Mark's been raising his little girls to have that kind of entrepreneurial spirit. They're out there selling lemonade and random stuff there. COVID kind of slowed down their footfall, Mark, but I think the ideas or their heart's in the right place.
Before COVID, we used to go into the transition year. So I've worked with 13 different schools, and we've taught transition year students. And some of them actually put real money in the market. I remember we went over to St. Mary's College in Buncrana in Donegal, and they put in something like €20 each into the kitty. And they grew their account from $500 to $1,200 in 1 year.
Wow.
We taught them to recognize the patterns, and they buy low, sell high, buy low, sell high.
What's some of the basic early teachings that you'd give to kids when it comes to investment?
The visual, to learn to read the charts, to be able to recognize the low points and the high points, and to know when to buy and when to sell. That's the first basic skill we give them. And kids' brains, because kids' brains are like their whole brain creatures. They've got a very active left brain and right brain. And they see patterns really easy. The challenge with us us adults is because we've got so much data dump, we become analytical, and our left brain, our visual brain, our right brain gets shut down, so we don't see the patterns. That's what happens. We get overloaded with information.
I think that they would have a lot less fear of failure in that way as well. If I,
more emotion around money.
I think a lot of people, if they invested something or they made a few kind of trades that went against them, there'd be like a little bit of shameless and like, it's gobshite. But that type of thing. But then at the end of the day, you don't risk anything. You're not going to get anything.
Yeah. And you've hit the nail on the head. If you were from another planet and you looked down this planet with 8 billion souls running around the planet trying to figure out how to make a living, and you said, well, who's the richest people on this planet? And then you discovered, what do they do? Stock market. You say, well, everybody must be in the stock market because it's proven over decades of time to be the most wealthiest and lucrative business on the planet. Why doesn't everybody not do it?
I think a lot of people, they're not educated enough in that specific area and the belief isn't there. But secondly, I think people think you need a lot of money to start. Realistically, for a beginner, how much amount of money is a good kind of starting amount? I know you can't just start on a euro, it's got to be a...
Yeah, 100 euros a month is perfect in an investment club, perfect, because you've leveraged, it's your 100 plus the other 1900.
Okay. And you're learning, obviously, as you go along.
You're learning massively along the way, and you're learning to master your emotions, because that's the big killer in the market, is the emotion battle. Sir John Templeton, one of our great lecturers, he was the 11th richest man of the time. He taught at the Tony Robbins event. He said, if you can master your emotions, you will master the market. Simple as.
It's interesting as well, because since I've been trying to systematize how I'm investing right now, and this is like the second month where I said, okay, this is the amount I'm going to put in, and this is how I'm going to weigh out the portfolio, that type of thing, with the different elements of risk and stuff like that. And then the day came where I was supposed to send the money in. I thought, I could use that money right now, do something, like go out or something, But I did. So I'm trying to make it just like a reflex. So it's every day on every month on this day, I send it over to the account and then take it from there. But I can see why people, if it's not taken out immediately, I think when people, this is another thing maybe that people that don't work for themselves. If I work for a big American software company, and I'm in their kind of stock buying program as well, which is great because they take it out before I get there. And then three times a year, they will do a purchase and add a discount, and I get that as a perk, which is great. Because I don't even think about it. It's like it doesn't exist. So perhaps I need to set up something like that as well, where it's a kind of like a direct debit or something, because making the decision every month is going to slow me down a little bit. It was a couple of days late, Mark. I'm not going to lie, this month, holding on there.
Yeah, no, you're right. That's why Investment Club works so well, because everybody sets up a direct debit from their personal bank account for 100 euros a month, and they know they've other 19 pairs of eyes looking at them, so there's that accountability as well. So that works quite well as well.
And how's it all now? I assume there would be physical face-to-face meetings and stuff before COVID. How different does it look like now?
It's all done by Zoom, and you guys are welcome to observe a club in action if you want. It's all done by Zoom, yeah.
Okay, very good. And how's that working? I assume it would work fine.
Works really well. It's very efficient, and we can share each other's screen, and it's a lot more efficient than the old round-the-table meetings, yeah.
Okay. So say if somebody was getting started and they didn't have access to a club straight away, what would be the step that would take to get started? Would you say go to a traditional provider of like wealth management? Would you go down the road of setting up an online brokerage account and just kind of testing it out that way? What would be the first steps you take?
Well, by joining an investment club, all of that stuff is already in place. The online account is in place, the bank account. So that is all done for you. And that, by you observing that on a month-by-month basis, you're learning how to do it for yourself. So I always say to people, the only reason you should join an investment club is to learn how to do it for yourself. So it's like you then can have your own personal account, and you can copy-paste what the club decisions are made. Does that make sense? Because it's like brain power between everybody.
It absolutely does make sense, because I like I said, with my first purchase of stock with my online account, I was like, I'm not sure if I'm even doing this right. I used to work, and I had exposure to the industry. I'd looked up a lot of videos and stuff like that. But even then, I was like, geez, I hope this works. And then hit send, you know. So there is a little bit of uncertainty when you're getting going. So maybe that is a good place to start as well with the club. Also, might be kind of nice, Mark, just to hang out with like-minded people and talk about cool companies and stuff. You know?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, I think a lot of people might be intimidated as well to kind of take that first step. Is there like entry-level kind of information online or YouTube videos or anything that people can have a read through first to kind of get familiarized themselves with terminology and stuff?
Yeah, I'll pop a few. We've done a few doodle videos which kind of explain the basic concepts, so I can pop them over to you to share with your community. And then if they like that, they're welcome just to observe a club in action without even making a commitment. So if any of your community or listeners would like to observe a club, or we can even send a recording of a meeting to them, they can get a feel for what it's like. So yeah, they're welcome to observe.
That'd be deadly. I think there'd be a lot of a take up on that as well. So like, Owen, we've talked a lot about the entry level stuff, getting people going. Cause that, I think getting the first step is like, it's like anything. It's like even saving the well. Like when you start to get a little bit of momentum, it's kind of like, all right, I've got this going. I don't want to lose my winning streak here. What about the next level? What about those people who have been diligent investors? They've been getting that S&P, so like the top 500 companies in America ETF. So like, you know, a bundle of stocks. That's the kind of standard safety bet for a long time. But if they want to kind of up their game a little bit, what's the type of areas that you'd recommend for those people to kind of dig into where there's a bit of opportunity to make a higher return?
Well, I mean, the timing for this podcast is very good because of COVID, there's a lot of companies in the airline industry, the hotel industry, the cruise ships, the casinos, the entertainment companies, they're still on their knees. And will be until, you know, everybody gets vaccinated and everybody's confident to fly again and go to hotels again and blah, blah, blah. So for any of your listeners out there and viewers, this is the time to take a real close look, because things like this only happen about every decade. Every decade you get a major pullback in the market. So there's tremendous value in the market right now. So yeah, take a look at those companies. And also pick the best companies in those industries. Like the S&P 500, has made about 10% return a year and has done for decades. But Warren Buffett, his fund has done 20%. So if you wanted to just be lazy, you could buy Warren Buffett's fund. And now you're tied into someone who consistently does 20% a year and has done for decades as well.
It's so, because do you know what propaganda is probably, maybe it is the right word, I'm not sure. But the kind of the messaging out there is that, you know, the market is the market. And you go, I talked to it, and just because I've got a work pension as well, I met with the pension advisor there. And he's saying, you know, the market's the market. If you can be guaranteed kind of like 6 or 7%, you know, take that and just kind of get on with your life. Like, that doesn't seem like it's, there's got to be a better or a faster way to do this, or, you know, something that give a little bit of exposure to some sort of upside more than that, you know?
Yeah. So that's what I was going to lead to. So then the next best thing from doing the Warren Buffett is look at the 500 companies, the S&P 500, and then pick the best of them. Because if the S&P 500, if the average is doing 10%, what is the top third doing? What is the top 20% doing? So that's the next step. So typically, if you, and we would do this, you can make about 30-40% a year, because now you're working with the creme de la creme, like the Premier League. Yeah, simple as.
It's weird that people wouldn't do, because that makes, when you say that to me, it makes complete sense. I just want to be with the, you know, the movers and shakers within the 500 company, right, and just the ones. I put some money into an ETF that was like a basket of goods for disruptive technologies. And I went through to look through all those companies, and I just saw there's huge potential for all of these companies that I was going through. So I put some money in that. But again, it was a little bit like, it did feel like a little bit more risky when I was going into it. But especially, I feel like I've got a few years to make some mistakes. I can get it back, you know, at some stage. So I'm trying to take some risks here. That's actually, before we, our last podcast, me and Mark kind of went through our 2021 goals just to kind of map out what we're trying to do this year. And one of the key concepts was that we wanted to up risk a lot of the things we're doing. Whenever we've done well, whether that's selling a property or just basically anything I've ever done, has been, it's only the times where I've taken the biggest risks when things have paid off, you know, exponentially. So everything we're doing, we're going to go through, like, me and Mark have an online t-shirt business through Amazon. We want to see if we can put some money behind that for advertising or something, you know, put some more skin in the game, because we've been quite passive with the whole thing. With investing, I want to invest in more, stocks with more upside. And even in work, I'm looking to do a different type of contract where there's a lot more upside, but that might take a little hit on the risk there. So I think that's something that people should look at as well.
Certainly. And then there's a whole area that people are not aware of, that most people just buy and hold and hope they do well, or buy and sell. We do this whole other thing called call options and put options. So we make money four ways in the market. We make money in the upside, we make money in dividend income, we make money in call option income and put option income. And that's phenomenal. Like, our returns this year, we've just gone through our average returns for this year. And you won't believe this. It's like, it doesn't make sense, but we've made 10% a month this year. Why? Because off COVID, the market got very volatile. When the market is very volatile, the premiums for the options go sky high. So normally when you sell a call option on a $20 stock, you make a dollar, which is about 5% a month. The same trade was making $2, $3, and in some cases, just remember when the market crashed in March and April?
Yeah.
In that time, we were making $4.20. So we were promising to sell a $20 call option. We were getting $4.20 for that in that month, in that 6 weeks. So the volatility has helped us do really well this year.
So the put options and the call options, they're like, the volatility is what's driving the value there. So you're saying, someone can buy that from you, saying, okay, this is a promise to buy at this level. And that's what the difference is. Okay. And so for that type of trading, that is a lot different than what people are kind of used to. And when you talk about that, it makes me think, like, okay, do I need to know a lot more about that? Or in the trade, or in the investment clubs, is there someone kind of centrally who is kind of giving his input on that? Or does that knowledge have to be within the group? Do you know?
Yeah. So again, when you observe a club's in action, you can look at our dashboards, which we've got a key performance indicator dashboard. You can see that there's call income, put income, dividend income. You can see that income has been used to buy more shares, and those shares then in turn collect income. So there's compound interest going on there, interest on interest. So at the club meeting, you actually see them do that. You see them selling the call option, bringing in the income. You see them selling the put option. So everything is visible for you to see. And through a process of repetition, you get to know it. And then in the Investment Club Network, we run education modules. So when people have the desire and they want to learn how to do it for themselves, they can go through some education modules as well.
Okay, good. Because again, this is something that there's not a lot of information, definitely not when in school, when you're growing up, which is something that we've talked about, you know, ad nauseum on the podcast, how if we were to design school, it would be a lot different. Before you arrived, I was talking to Mark about a situation where if somebody had some sales skills, they could have been doing a lot better with their with what their skill set is, you know. But if they can't sell it to anybody, no one's going to buy it, you know. So I think that type of mindset needs to be taught in schools as well, that, you know, it's not the degree actually won't do much for you, but they kind of sell that to you when you're in school. They give you this list. I remember getting a list, Mark. I don't know about you. I think it was in transition year, so maybe it would have been great if Owen dropped by. But you know, when you get that list and it has kind of average salaries and then the degree that those people have, and you're like, well, I'll just pick this from a menu. I'll live like this person. All I have to do is get these, jump through this hoop, and then they put another hoop there. And then you say, okay, this is the last hoop though, right? I'm going to get that big salary if I get this one. And then you get out of college, then you get to a place like Davie and they're like, oh, you know, we can do your chartered exams here again. I'm like, I did all these exams. What's this? This is bullshit. Like, do you know what I mean? So unless you get out of that kind of hoop jumping nonsense. But the school kind of puts you on that path, and it doesn't want you to be financially free. And then like me and Mark were talking about this before as well, I've learned as well, in Ireland, if you hold ETFs every 8 years, it's a taxable event. Are the government trying to keep the people in poverty? What is that about? That's
exactly.
When I heard that, Owen, I lost sleep. I was so angry how that was set up. Like, and I did the math over, over 30 years. That's a huge amount of loss that those people have taken for themselves as well, because they've taken that off the table, so the compounding goes away. Anyway, yeah. My little rant,
No, you're right. And I wrote a book called So You Want to Be Financially Free. And in the book, I said your greatest liability to become financially free is tax. And so there are various strategies to do that. For anybody listening, you can set up a self-administered retirement trust and then you pay zero tax. There's various tax strategies to efficiently trade the market as well, which you can do.
I think I got to look into that, because
I trade through a company, so I only pay 12.5% corporation tax. So I've got a self-administered retirement. Some of my money is self-administered, zero tax. Some of it is through a company, 12.5% tax. Some of it is through an investment club, and some of it is through individuals. So they all have different implications, different liquidity opportunities, and different tax rates. So you can do a blend.
It's got to be something that people look into, because, like, a generous sales environment, if you get your big bonus, 51%, I think, is what we're playing on a top line. Mm-hmm. So that's six months of the year just goes right to the government. What do you think, Mark? I think that's fair. Anyway.
Yeah. I must, because I'm doing it. Yeah.
Another thing here, Mark and Luke, if you have a self-administered retirement trust and you get that big bonus, you can actually put that into your self-administered pre-tax. So you don't even pay tax on it. So it goes in pre-tax, and then while it's in there, you pay no tax on the growth.
I gotta get going on this, Mark. What do you think? We need to put our heads together and fucking sort this out.
This is why we do the podcast, Lou.
It's why we do the podcast. Open our minds and everything like that. So I know, Owen, we've been having a chat here about investment quotes, investing, getting people going, getting people started. We're definitely going to, if you wouldn't mind even sharing a link to people that we can send our audience to have a look at the clubs, or even a link to a video or something like that. I think that would be so valuable for them.
Yeah, so if they want to go to tisn.ie and they click on podcasts, they'll get some good podcasts where there's a guy with Dublin South FM interviewed me about 12 times over a period of a year and a half. So that's a good resource, the podcast and tisn.ie.
Perfect. We'll put that in the show notes as well. We do have a bit of a tradition here as well on the Shark Pod. I don't know if you're aware of this. We've got a bit of a lightning round of questions here. We try to pick our brains of the guests to see what the story is. It's kind of Mark's party piece. He's got them lined up over there in Grace area, in Glenageary. Mark, what do you think? What's the burning questions here this week for Owen?
Yeah, we'll start off nice and simple. So what are some of the apps that you use the most?
Personally or for investing, is it?
Either or, yeah.
Well, we use an app called Alpha Plan, which is one of the best softwares for trading the market. Alpha Plan.
Very good. Yep. Any others come to mind?
Let me just look at my phone and see what I use frequently. Then I have a charting app called TC2000. So for charting TC2000 for trading.
So charity, is that what you said?
Charting.
All right, sorry. Yeah.
So they would be the ones that I would use most on the iPhone.
Okay.
Yeah.
What's the best business idea, if you've had one, that you've never acted upon?
Best business idea. The best business idea is to invest in the best businesses in the world, period. I've acted on that, so.
I like it. And let's get Bill Gates working for us.
Exactly. Yeah.
We've been listening to him for lately quite a lot. Let's try to get something back from him.
Exactly. Yeah.
Okay. So what time do you get up at in the morning, and what time do you go to sleep?
So I would typically wake up around about 7 a.m. and just clear all the whatever stuff needs to be cleared. The stock market doesn't normally have to. So the first half of the day would be spent either, I live here beside a beach, so going for a run or for a walk. half two, then the market opens. So we have some meetings with some of our teams, and then some of our clubs meet in the evening. So typically we'd finish up about 9 p.m. and then I'd go to bed around 12 o'clock.
Okay.
How much money is enough money?
How much money is enough money? Well, if you're serious and if you do the maths, to be totally, totally, totally financially free and to have no worries, you need to accumulate. Well, it depends on your return. But you need to be looking at building up about $1 million to be able to sit back and say, right, I can live with that now.
Okay. Is it who you know or is it what you know?
When it comes to investing, it's only you in the market, so it's what you know and your experience. When it comes to doing what we do, building businesses and encouraging investment clubs around the world, it's networking, going to events and networking. So a lot of people that I run our business around the world, I would have met them at Tony Robbins events or Joe Dispenza or T. Harv Eker. So definitely get out there and get out to events to network, yeah.
Okay. If you could advise somebody to learn one skill, what would it be?
To learn how to invest.
Awesome.
It's like it's very consistent. Like, so Mark, what do you think? Last two questions. What's the burning ones? What's on your mind? What do you need to know?
Okay, if you could recommend one book to people, what would it be?
Think and Grow Rich.
Okay.
Think and Grow Rich. Yeah.
Is that Napoleon Hill? That was one of the and the very early episodes of Shark Pod when we had very poor equipment. Me and Mark went through that book. Remember, Mark, we went through that one. Yeah. As well. That had a big impact on me as well.
Yeah, I remember. I haven't read that now, but you did.
It's like it's written quite a long time ago. So if you can get past that, just kind of the language,
the oldie feel about it, yeah.
Yeah, a bit of an oldie feel about it, but yeah. It's actually available on YouTube and an audiobook. That's how I listen to it. So I got a lot of that. That's I put that in the show notes as well. I think all the sharks out there need to get on it. Mm-hmm.
Okay, last one. What advice would you give to the 18-year-old, Owen?
Start investing earlier. I didn't start until I'd done 12 years in the fish farm. So everybody should start as soon as possible. Because Mark, if you understand compound interest, the earlier you start, the better.
Yeah. Yeah, makes sense.
Start early, invest often. Owen O'Malley, thank you so much for joining us today on the Shark Pod. Really, really insightful. I really want to learn more about these investment clubs, not just because I think it seems like a great way to learn about getting a beyond average return, but also I just like to hang out with people who are interested in the same stuff that you're interested in. So after that, we'll put a lot of stuff in the show notes where people can find these types of clubs near them. But in the meantime, thank you very much for joining us.
You're very welcome. I'll email you a few doodly videos. They're short 2-minute, 3-minute videos that they can take a look at as well.
Okay. Perfect.
Perfect. Thanks very much.
Good. Cheers, Owen.
Thanks. Cheers.